You know, it's shocking because when I was in primary school, when I was in sixth class, we were trying to get this new building, the one we're in right now. So I came back and I found the new building just built, and I missed when they were knocking down the old building. And I've built so much memories here, and I've lived beside it. So every time I pass by this primary school, I just remember everything, you know, when life was so simple and just being a kid and you didn't know what was yet to come in the future. So every time I pass by here, I just always wish that maybe sometime I can go back to being a kid. You know, it's very relaxing to get your freedom after 4 years, of course, but it's very hard as well. As much as it's beautiful and amazing and, you know, it's great to be free, but, you know, adapting to a new environment after 4 years because you're so used to it, and it was like the most essential 4 years of my life where I was building my life and just building my personality and who I was. So just going back to building, you know, what I have to build my future, where all my friends have passed already that stage, and I have to go back and start from that place where I just left off. You know, just sleeping on a bed, having your own freedom to open and close a door, walk out of the house whenever you want to. Seeing my friends as well just grow, and all my nieces and nephews turn into, you know, either big children or big men. And, you know, just for me, that was a lot to take in, because I left them such a small age, and to see them just showed me the time difference I was actually in there. So it was very hectic and hard for me. Each prison differs from another one, and each officer controls his prison with his own rules. So you will go in, basically you have one guard beats you up in a different place with a different style, and then you have another prison that, you know, tortures you maybe psychologically more than physically. And then you have to go into a cell, and you're 30 people in a cell. You have to live 24/7 in that cell with people, so you're basically never ever getting your privacy, and you're in a 30-centimeter place sleeping at, and you have a human being on your right and a human being on your left, and you're like that for such a long time. They could psychologically take your food or your clothes, and physically take your clothes and your food, and you can't do anything about it. They'd beat you and you can't do anything about it. They'd strip you and they'd leave you outside. They'd have other prisoners urinate on other prisoners and you can't do anything about it. They throw garbage on prisoners and leave you in the sun for the whole day. You know, there's so much. There's honey thrown on you so you can insects all gather on you. You know, you have to crawl on the boiling ground as well, the hot surface of the ground. So there's so many, you know, torture that I've seen over the 4 years, and it's a lot to speak about. But the mental torture as well is that they tell you we're in control of you. Like I said many times before, is that they shave your head and they leave patches purposely there just to tell you, you know, we're going to do this to you and you can't object and you can't protest against it. So my hunger strikes for me were very important, of course, and they were hard and long. Like, as long as prison days were, hunger strikes made prison days longer. So you know, they'd always, that's when the mental struggle and the mental fight with them is, because they'd leave you until you basically, your blood sugar would drop so low, it would drop to 24 or 25 and the device would give you low. And that's when, you know, they'd actually leave you and abandon you to tell you, okay, if you die, we won't care about you. And you just had to push that one step further till you took what you want. And I think it's the last hunger strike, as much as, you know, the political pressure, my sister's pressure, the Irish pressure as well. But I think as well, my last hunger strike played a huge role, because, you know, I put myself in a state where I nearly died, and I was on a wheelchair and I was on a bed, moved around. And then, of course, when, you know, when I broke the hunger strike is when Leo Varadkar, the new Taoiseach, you know, became Taoiseach. So I had a new door of hope open. So I said, okay, I have to stop my hunger strike. And that's when I started eating back again. The sentence trial for us was, okay, it's going to be postponed again. But when he came in and then he starts the opening speech, and then, you know, he starts saying the sentences, he started off with life sentences. So it was very emotional for us that, you know, some of us were going to stay, some of us were going to go. People were going to stay 25 years, some people were going to stay 10. So we all, first of all, we were always in the unknown, that we were always just postponed. So at that moment when people got life sentences for me, it was very emotional, because some of them were my friends. So while I was, you know, I was with them and I was hugging them and telling them everything's going to be all right, you know, don't worry. And that's when I actually started to tear up, and then I heard a lot of, you know, Ibrahims. So I thought I was in them, and they got sentenced 15 years. So I was like, okay, I got sentenced 15 years. So I was just thinking about how I'm going to live the next 15 years, because when he said all the Ibrahims, I was actually hugging my friend, telling him everything's going to be all right. And then that's when actually, you know, one of my other friends in prison was like, you know, you're going to be acquitted. And I was like, no, man, I heard my name with the 15-year sentence. And he was like, no, you're going to be acquitted. And then he came to the acquittals and he was like, Ibrahim Halawa, acquitted. And I started to cry more. And it was actually as much as his joy of happiness that I had to go back, because, you know, my mom, who was diagnosed with cancer, so I had to go back to her. But of course that I cried, that it's unjust and it's unfair that I have to leave all of those people behind, and just, you know, they have to see me walk out those doors, and they're going to have to stay behind. And at the end of the day, the door is going to lock behind me. It's actually very emotional, because when I was leaving the cell, everyone was crying. I was crying because these are people you've built 4 years of memory with. And like I said, you spend 24/7 with them, and you don't even spend that much time with your family. Every day you're here with your family, someone's out, you're out, your sister's out, your dad's out. But over there, you're between four walls, and you've made so much memories. So at the end of the day, they've become basically like family to you. And a lot of them, you're so sure of their innocence. So for me to leave them behind and for me to get my freedom is just shows how corrupt the system over there is, because, you know, it just wants to get rid of European citizens or other, you know, foreign citizens, when it just wants to torture and, you know, mentally and physically, you know, as well, torture their citizens, which is unfair and unjust. And I think that's, you know, that's a crime to humanity. We never got a mayor in prison, so after 4 years you see yourself and you see the change you've actually become after 4 years. And for me, you know, it shows from the man I looked into, you know, as I looked into mayor as a kid when I was before prison, and then after prison I saw myself into a man, and it just has to prospect for me the future life and what I have to do, and it just shows who I've become. So it's very, very emotional for me looking into mirror every morning. My plans, you know, I really want to work with, for me, the really close case to my heart, of course, is prisoners. But while I was in prison, I was always looking forward to going home, and home really meant, you know, a very powerful word to me. So home, it was very critical for me. So the homeless people, I really want to work with them, because I say this story everywhere I go, is when I was in prison, I had this guy who was beside me, and he was writing a consent form to the warden, and he was asking the warden, can he bring in his family into prison? And I was like, are you crazy, man? Like, who the hell wants to do that? And he was like, yeah, because I have, you know, they don't have shelter outside and they don't have food. And I was like, but the food here is terrible, and how are you going to bring them here? And, you know, the officers are going to be in control of your family. He was like, at the end of the day, at least they have shelter. So for me, that's really when a human being hit rock bottom, that he wants to bring his family into one of the worst prisons like in Egypt. So I really want to work with the homeless case. I want to work with the refugee case. I want to work with orphans, because I've seen orphans in prison who, you know, didn't know when they were going to be released. Who are they going to go home to as well, because they had no family? I want to, like I said, refugees, homeless, orphans. I want to work with all prisoners, humanitarian cases. And that's what I really want to do. I want to write my book as well, because people only will know what's really going on in the other side of the world until they see it or hear it. And I think putting a book out there is going to be important. I don't regret protesting, because I did nothing illegal by any law in any country. Hence why, of course, I don't believe in the Egyptian judicial system, but even a corrupt judicial system yet set me, you know, proved me innocent, acquitted me of all charges. So for me to be proven innocent after 4 years just says, you know, what they did to me is wrong, because we're going to, you know, arrest you for 4 years and you've done no crime against our law, so you're free to go, after, you know, psychologically torturing me, after physically torturing me, and then just telling you you're free to go. Of course, that for me was very hard, but I've stood for a cause, you know, every human should stand for, and that's, you know, to fight for people who don't have democracy or don't have freedom. And if you don't have democracy or you don't have freedom in that country, you have to support them to get that, because we live in a freedom democratic country, and it's not only made for us, it's made for every human being. So for them, I had to stand up for that right, and for my friends that died. So if I go back in time, I would do it all over again.